Today's topic of discussion is homeopathic approach in cases related to central nervous system. So when we begin and when we talk about neurology is everywhere, where we are talking, we are seeing, where we are walking. So in short, neurology is what makes us function day in and day out. So when we are understanding the case from the homeopathic perspective, what we need to know is certain key points. Key points means suppose we are looking into a case. So the presentation of the case is one aspect, and understanding a case and conceptualizing the case is very important because it reflects in the management and therapeutic strategy. Other important point, that apart from the homeopathic therapeutic forces which we use, the other important requisites for managing neurological cases, the ancillary and auxiliary line of treatment which is required in neurology care, the prescription which we are going to make requires a detailed knowledge of pathophysiological understanding and integration. What other concepts which are important is the evolution, the causation and the progress of the disease. And foremost and the most important thing is, as we all know, the functions leads to the structure formation. It's like need is necessity of all invention. So because of the requirement of a function, the structures get materialized. So whether it is a normal function or an abnormal function, but the basis of this function is the structure from which this function originates. So all these key points are very important when we handle the cases. So we will begin by taking case by case and understanding the applied aspect related to clinical as well as the application in terms of homeopathic principles. These are few of the cases which I have experienced in this 5 to 6 years of working in the IPD and in emergency services department. So first case would be of a female. This is a case of a female of 45 years. She was brought to a casualty. She is a laborer by profession, and when she was brought, she was in acute distress. Basically, she was carried by two people. One of her daughter was there, and her uncle had accompanied the patient. The complaints which she precipitated was vertigo since 7 days. There was a sensation that as if everything is spinning around her. She couldn't walk, she couldn't stand. She could just shut her eyes and would just lie down quietly on sides and would not move. Vertigo would get precipitated on opening the eyes, and she would just lie down on the back. Other concomitant symptoms which were present with this complaint was nausea, perspiration and salivation. And she vomited the ingesta. So if you see the entire symptomatology, it consists of a vertigo. Primary symptom is vertigo. And the important concomitants which are there is nausea, perspiration and salivation. So other examination findings were, apparently everything was normal, the investigations were normal, but symptoms persisted. So how do we diagnose this case? That is an important thing. As I have already mentioned, that it is a single symptom of vertigo. So it's a monosymptomatic, and there is no associated case, other symptoms like imbalance or a patient having a preceding history of headaches or preceding history of any other fever or any other signs of infective illnesses in the past. The other important thing is we have to differentiate whether this vertigo is a peripheral origin vertigo or the central origin vertigo. With the word peripheral vertigo, it means that vertigo which originates other than the central nervous system. So whether it is inner ear origin, labyrinthine origin or vestibular in origin. So we have to differentiate that. So the diagnosis of this case was benign positional vertigo. The closest differentiations which were coming were vertebrobasilar insufficiencies and labyrinthitis. How do we rule out? whatever basilar insufficiency is a condition which is purely vascular in origin. The structure involved is the vessel, where the blood supply to the brainstem is impaired either because of something which is pressing out from outside, or there is something which is within the vessel which obliterates the flow of blood to the brainstem. So the intravascular thing which can obliterate the flow is atherosclerotic changes in the vessels, right? So if you understand the age is around 40 to 45 years, which is very unlikely possibility. Generally, in whatever basilar insufficiencies, what we see, the symptoms get precipitated in recumbent position when a person is standing and patient is absolutely fine when the patient lie down, or there is a certain position which ameliorates the patient. But in this case, if you see, each and every position is worsening the patient, even the movement of head. So motion aggravation is the key symptom in this case, or the key modality in this case. So when you label as benign positional vertigo, the positional word positional means any position you take or any movement at the neck would precipitate the vertigo. So this case fits more into this diagnosis. This is how we have to go about, and there is no other symptom. Neurologically, patient is not having any cerebral signs which are positive, like Romberg's on tandem walking, on other signs are all negative, right?
Do we need to do any investigations for?
The investigations which are important is the Barra test, which is generally done by an ENT specialist, where we have to make the patient lie down in a certain inclined position. You have to make the patient sit first, and then he has to be inclined in a certain position and the angle has to be achieved. And basically, benign positional vertigo is said to be there has been the change in the perilymph exchange, which is located in the inner ear in the semicircular canals, right? So if there is any change in this, there is a sensation of spinning which is experienced and which is labeled as vertigo. So, and other important things are to differentiate peripheral vertigo from the central vertigo is, first, peripheral vertigo you may find nystagmus, and at the same time central vertigos like cerebellar origin vertigos may also have nystagmus. The only difference is in peripheral vertigo the nystagmus may disappear or may get fatigued when the patient is made to look at a certain point. That is, when the patient fixes his eyes, the vertigo, the nystagmus may disappear. Whereas in central causes, even if a patient is looking at a particular object, the nystagmus may not get fatigued and the nystagmus may persist. Generally, benign positional vertigos are said to be more in acute origin, whereas central origin vertigos are said to be a chronic case, because most probable causes are maybe an either a vascular event means there is a ischemia or a thrombotic episode which is going on for a long time, which has led to a central vertigo, predominantly cerebellar insufficiencies. Another thing which can lead to a cerebral, this is either a mass in the cerebellum, right, which can lead to vertigo, but at the same time patient may have ataxias, which is a very important key for a cerebellar diagnosis. So in short, if you understand the balance of the body is either the visual inputs which go into the brains, which make us oriented to the environment, right? And the other source which make us oriented to the environment is the somatosensory apparatus. Means the